song.
Good evening. Hello. How's it going? Thank you all for coming out. I just want to ask if there's honor students here that need to make proof that you're here, see me after. But it's good to see some of my students, some new faces, some old faces. Thank you for coming. And on behalf of Paradise Valley Community College and the PVCC Philosophical Society, welcome. And I'm going to introduce to you tonight Dr. Peter Redpath. He is a historian of philosophy, a Thomist scholar, and author of several books. And he's also a member of our community. He and I are going to be partnering together to bring more public philosophy to the local area. So I would like to introduce Dr. Peter Redpath. Peter Redpath.
Thank you very much for coming to this historic meeting. I call it historic because Dr. Hancock and I have been involved in events internationally, philosophical congresses, going back to the 1980s. In fact, one of the first ones was in Tempe, Arizona, around 1980, where we started to engage in a program for attempting to recover Western philosophy and reconnect philosophy and science and wisdom. And I said it's an historic event because we, in each of these meetings that we held in various venues, ranging from places like Poland and in Warsaw and Lublin, or in Rome, or in France and Germany, they're all part of that project. And a few years ago, I set up this school called the Aquinas School of Leadership to engage in leadership training. As part of that organization, you can check that out online if you want to get background on that and on me. A short while ago, we decided to have a lecture series, and this is the inaugural lecture in that Aquinas School of Leadership lecture series that Dr. Kelly Fitzsimmons Burton has graciously invited us, along with Paradise Valley Community College and their Philosophical Society, to deliver here. So that's one of the that's a special event within all of these historic events that I've been mentioning. Dr. Hancock is an internationally recognized scholar. He holds a Freeman Chair in philosophy at Rockhurst Jesuit University. He's also a graduate of the University of Oklahoma, among other places, where he was there on a track scholarship. So he's quite an athlete, among other things.
Many years ago.
Very well-rounded human being. And one of the nicest persons that you'd ever want to meet and have as a professional colleague and a friend. Two of his specialties are in metaphysics and in ethics. And what I want to do now is to introduce Dr. Hancock to you so he can talk to you about St. Thomas and Aristotle and what you might be able to learn. We all might be able to learn from them about human happiness.
About happiness, yeah. Right. Thank you, Dr. Redpath. Yes, I'm happy to be here, and that's precisely what I'm going to do, talk about happiness. And I'm going to use St. Thomas Aquinas and Aristotle as my guide as we try to explore the nature of happiness. But I'm not going to talk about them just because they're a couple of venerable names from the past. There's this tendency, you know, to revere people because they become like museum pieces. Aristotle, a philosopher in the 4th century B.C. St. Thomas Aquinas, a philosopher in the 13th century. But I myself am very interested in the history of philosophy. but not because I just have an antiquarian interest, because I'm interested in things in the past. A philosopher named Etienne Gilson once said that what you should be interested in always is a living philosophy. And he argued that some of the greatest living philosophers are people who died even a couple of millennia ago. Someone like Aristotle, and almost a millennium ago, someone like Thomas Aquinas. They're worth talking about because they're still very relevant. They're as timely as ever. And that's why I'm going to talk about them to you. Aristotle said long ago that everybody wants to be happy. But if you observe, not a lot of people spend a lot of time exploring what happiness means. And it's important to think about what happiness is and how to get it. And if you also think about happiness, you have to think about the things that can get in your way about being happy, the pitfalls that can prevent you from being happy. And so I'm going to provide some observations that emanate out of the pages of the work of St. Thomas Aquinas and Aristotle that will help us answer some of those questions and remedy some of those deficiencies, avoiding pitfalls especially. Let's see if I can get here. This is a famous centerpiece of a painting by Raphael, 16th century, Plato and Aristotle. The painting is called The School of Athens, and there are hundreds of philosophers depicted in that painting. And right at the center is Plato and Aristotle coming down a staircase. And you'll notice Plato is pointing to the heavens and Aristotle is affirming this world. And that's one of the reasons I think Aristotle is such an effective guide for happiness. Aristotle thought theories were always guilty until proven innocent. He's very interested in practical experience and how people can find their way in the world. In fact, the book he's holding there is his book on the ethics. Plato is holding a book on metaphysics, and so Raphael knew enough about philosophy to contrast the two. And this is Thomas Aquinas. There are a lot of old stodgy pictures of Thomas Aquinas. I always like this one. This is a picture of him as a young seminarian, and that's actually painted by Peter Paul Rubens, so it's a great work of art, I always believe. So I'm going to talk about some of the wisdom about happiness that comes out of these volumes. One by Aristotle, the Nicomachean Ethics. His father's name was Nicomachus, and his son's name was Nicomachus. So the name Nicomachean Ethics does double duty. And the emphasis on family is part of the pathway into understanding the nature of happiness for Aristotle. Excuse me. For Aristotle. So it's not a surprise that he titled his book that way. And St. Thomas's work on happiness, because they both thought that ethics is a way to understand the pursuit of happiness. So these are books on ethics, but ethics is another way of understanding happiness. So that's why we use them as our source. He wrote a commentary on Aristotle's ethics, and that's the source book for our understanding of his view of happiness. He wrote about 8 million words, St. Thomas did. He died before he's 50 years old and wrote 8 million words. So he wrote a lot on happiness, as you can imagine, but a very condensed explanation of his account of happiness can be found in that book. And Dennis Prager, that's a name you probably know. He's got a talk show there out of San Diego. I read this book recently, Happiness is a Serious Problem, and he doesn't mention Aristotle or St. Thomas in the book, but it's just chock full of some interesting examples and some themes. And I knew I'd read it recently, so I wanted to give him credit because I knew it was going to come out in my talk, some of the examples he gives. In outline, this is basically what I'm going to do. And the first item is happiness is a moral obligation. In fact, Dennis Prager titles that as the first chapter of his book, the first chapter in his book, and I think that's a nice starting point because Aristotle would very much endorse thinking of happiness as a moral obligation. And there are two reasons that happiness is a moral obligation. The first is that you owe it to yourself to be happy. Why do you owe it to yourself to be happy? Because you ought to be all that you can be. You ought to be the kind of person that nature intended you to be. The kind of excellent example of human nature, of the human person. So emphasis on human nature is big in Aristotle's conception of happiness. Also, you should care about happiness. Happiness is a moral obligation because you're not born into this world for yourself alone, so you should care about the happiness of others.
Okay.
So, Aristotle, if you asked him what his profession was, he would not have told you he was a philosopher. He would have told you that he was a biologist. He was keenly interested in biology, and he came by that interest honestly because his father and his father before him, were men of medicine. They were medical doctors. In fact, Aristotle's father, Nicomachus, was court physician to one of the most powerful men in the world, Philip of Macedon. That name may not ring a bell, but his son was Alexander the Great. So if Aristotle grew up in the court of Philip of Macedon, he knew Alexander the Great. He ran with fast company, and he had a friendship with Alexander the Great all of Alexander's life. And Alexander died in 323 BC, and Aristotle died in 322 BC, and that wasn't entirely a coincidence. Because he grew up in a household where medicine was important, he was a very keen observer of nature and biological issues, and he had biological interest to the end of his life. And in fact, when Alexander went eastward to conquer the world, he would sometimes send back to Aristotle curious biological specimens that he found in the plant kingdom and the animal kingdom. So it's more than just a hobby for Aristotle, his interest in biology. In fact, Darwin said, as he studied biology and different biologists historically, he said that next to him, Darwin, he thought Aristotle arguably was the best biologist. So that's an interesting fact about Aristotle. Now, the reason that's relevant is because Aristotle ties in happiness with the biology of being a human being. There's an old saying in ethics that as a person's philosophy of the human person goes, so goes one's ethics, and so goes one's account of happiness. And so that's another way of saying that you have to know what it is to be a human being, to know how a human being ought to live his or her life, to know how a human being ought to be happy. And Aristotle basically took that to the bank. So for him, happiness is something that's species-specifically human. If you think about it, that's just common sense. And Aristotle is the great champion of common sense philosophy. As I said before, he doesn't really have much truck for just theories. He's interested in having both feet on the ground. He even has an expression where he said that there's nothing in your intelligence that's not first in your senses. That's why in that portrait with Plato there, he's affirming this world. He's grounded in sense experience. And he believes that human beings are species-specifically destined for happiness, so they have the capacity for happiness in a way that the other animals do not. If you think about it, this is just common sense, animals are interested in avoiding pain, and they're interested in having satisfaction in life, but they don't understand what happiness is. They wouldn't be equipped to have the self-reflection necessary to know what happiness is. And that's Aristotle's point, that happiness is something unique to human life. And because it's specific to human life, you have to be careful to understand what happiness will entail. Because people often make mistakes about what happiness is, he says. A lot of people think happiness is just feeling good, that you feel good at this time, or you feel good at that time. But he says that is not what happiness is, because again, that seems to run afoul of common sense. If you think about it, that's true. So at 1 o'clock, I feel very happy. At 2 o'clock, I don't feel so hot. At 3, I feel anxious. At 4, I'm depressed. Hey, at 5, I'm back to being euphoric. Well, then my happiness would be on a kind of yo-yo. And Aristotle says that can't be how we understand happiness philosophically. Happiness has to be something stable and permanent, something that endures, so we can understand how a human being is developing toward his or her happiness. Also, happiness is not the same as having fun. Having fun is something, again, very transient, and it lacks that permanence necessary, Aristotle thought, for a common sense grasp of happiness. Happiness is also not the same as success. He thinks a lot of people mistake happiness for that. But it's not the same as success because often you will meet people who are very successful and you sense they're unhappy, even miserable people. So that won't fly either. So have to be careful not just understanding what happiness is, but understanding what happiness is not. Now, with regard to what happiness is, Aristotle again associates it with our human nature. He says happiness is not feeling good, it's not having fun, it's not being successful. What happiness is living well in a very broad sense. Living well in such a way that you acquire such self-mastery that you can use your intelligence so that you make really smart choices, so that you progressively actualize your potentials as a human being. So in the end, you wind up flourishing as a human being. So you live so constructively as to gradually realize all you can be as a human being. So happiness, then, is a kind of self-actualization. And in this way, you become an admirable person, not just in the eyes of others, but you become an admirable person in your own eyes. And that sense of well-being, there's a kind of glow of excellence that comes from that. And he thinks that's part of the real spirit of happiness. So if I think if Aristotle were alive today, he would say that some of these lessons have been forgotten about the close association of happiness with human nature. And our happiness today has been put at peril for that reason. And he would want to remind people of that. So that's the reason why you owe it to yourself to be happy. Happiness is a moral obligation with regard to yourself. But you owe it to other people also to be happy. You need to foster and help them in their happiness, because human beings have to live in relationship with others in order to have meaningful lives. And again, Aristotle says a lot of it has to do with motivation. Have you noticed this? That when you feel happy, when you're very aware of your happiness, you're more motivated to devote time and energy, even at the measure of some sacrifice, to help other people. When you have a sense of happiness, you're motivated to do that. And so happiness is something that even motivates moral obligation, and then it rebounds on your happiness. Dennis Prager says, if you don't believe that, ask a child who was brought up by an unhappy parent. Ask a child who was brought up by an unhappy parent if happiness is a moral obligation. He or she will give you an answer. Or ask a spouse who's married to an unhappy husband or wife. In fact, you can look at it from the standpoint of the parent, too, because parents, we know, feel some sense of unhappiness if their children are unhappy. A parent is only as happy as his or her least happy child, the saying goes. And Aristotle would appreciate this reference to the family, because he thought, as I said before, he was suspicious of theories, because he didn't think that you could understand ethics, let alone happiness, by seeking out some philosopher up in his ivory tower and asking him about moral life and how happiness worked. He said, that's not how you do it. You want to know how happiness works? You want to understand the principles of happiness? You go and study, examine families. You find a good, successful, effective, happy family. Observe the parents in that family. See why they were able to bring up children who are a blessing to themselves, their family, and the wider community. And then you'll see how happiness works. And so they have, Aristotle has a lot to say about happiness, as does St. Thomas Aquinas. St. Thomas, commenting on Aristotle and this business about family, at one point says that someone will have a hard time being happy if they didn't have good parents, St. Thomas says. Doesn't mean it's impossible. And by parents here, he doesn't necessarily mean biological parents. He means that because children are dependent on adults, if they didn't have somebody to give them very good, sound adult supervision and direction, give them role models for what it is to be happy, they will have a harder time habituating themselves to the task of being happy as adults. So you disadvantage a child if you don't provide that kind of adult role model. That's what St. Thomas meant when he said, without good parents, you can't be happy. And Aristotle says something, when I first read it, it shocked me. He said, children cannot be happy. And it took me a long time to figure out what he meant by that. And he doesn't mean that they're unhappy. He says they're neither happy nor unhappy, because happiness is an adult business. Children are on the pathway to acquiring the habits, the virtues that put them on the pathway to achieving happiness. But they don't have the moral maturity, they don't have the formation yet to master their impulses, as children have to master eventually through the help of adult supervision. And since they are so dependent on adults to give them that kind of guidance, they're not there yet. They may get eventually to the threshold of happiness. But as children, happiness is just a category that doesn't apply to them because it's an adult category. It's not as harsh as it sounds because in Aristotle's day, being an adult was probably at age 14, so childhood was perhaps narrower then. But I think that emphasis on the family, that insight into the family, that that's the crucible of happiness, is something that Aristotle again would say would be a good lesson that should have been kept across the generations. And if he were living in modern day America, he thinks that we've let that lesson slip away from us. And if we're going to restore our cultural and individual happiness, we need to get back to a sense of that connectedness. The second thing I'm going to address here with you is, this is kind of paradoxical, but in one's pursuit of happiness, one should not overlook the tragic side of life. That sounds somewhat odd, but the ancient Greeks were very keen on this. And you know, that's the culture that wrote all those great tragedies, from Aeschylus, Sophocles, Euripides. You probably read Oedipus Rex in high school. The Greeks wanted you to pay some attention to the possibility that tragedy can occur in life, and some tragedy, hopefully small or minimal amount, will occur in everybody's life. We'll all have some kind of loss, and you have to pay attention to this, or it can derail, it can upset your happiness. So it sounds odd, but actually it can actually fortify and be a benefit to your happiness if you don't ignore, don't forget about the tragic possibilities of life. When you study those Greek plays like Euripides or Sophocles, they weren't intended to scare you. They were intended to provide an object lesson to remind you of that possibility of loss. And it's just a matter of not being naive, but being realistic. And so you can't forget about that. You can't just put that on the shelf or bury it under a bushel and pretend that it's not a possibility. You have to resolve that you can still be happy even if you experience losses, and we all will in life. And so it's always have to keep that reminder. I thought of this recently when I was at a restaurant, and there was a group of women sitting next to me. And you know, I think almost 100 children died this year of this flu epidemic that went across the country. I think it was 97, I heard, was the last count. And they were talking about this, and one of the women said, well, if my child, she had, I think, 5 children, I think I eavesdropped enough to get that information. She had 5 children. She had said, if one of my children died, and a single child die like that, the undertaker would just have to put me in the coffin too. I couldn't go on. And I thought, well, that's understandable. When talking about the death of a child, we're likely to say all kinds of extreme things. But it struck me because not too long ago, I had read a biography of the great composer Johann Sebastian Bach. And Bach, get this, he had 20 children. He had 2 wives. He had 20 children. And only 10 of those, you say, only 10's a lot, but 10 of those children alone lived in adulthood. So he buried 10 children. Can you imagine that? Imagine going to that many funerals of your own children. But by all accounts, Bach was a wonderfully well-adjusted, beloved person, very happy, well-adjusted, saw himself as a creature of God, wrote all that marvelous music, and he was a very happy person, which seems to me to belie what that woman was thinking. It's because back in that historical context, people had to deal with death. It was part of the tragic side of life. They didn't avoid it. They resolved to deal with it when it came their way. My own grandmother had 13 children, and she lost 2 children. She was a rock-solid person with both feet on the ground, never suffered fools gladly, but she was a very happy person, one of the happiest I ever knew. So it need not be what people sometimes imagine it to be who haven't experienced it yet. And the historical context, I think, is very revealing about that. And the good news is, one of the things that's been happening lately is social scientists have weighed in on this happiness business. They've kind of discovered the subject of happiness and doing studies on it. And I read one social scientist, I was at the dentist's office and read a magazine, I think it was actually actually National Geographic, and there was an article on happiness in there written by a psychologist. And he'd done a study, and he said there's some good news when you experience these kinds of trauma and this kind of grief in life, that he claims that there's a kind of happiness thermostat that we have. You'll be completely upended by grief or distress, but if you just wait it out, you'll kind of settle back down to your natural temperament. Now, if you get into cycles of trauma, PTSD and all that kind of thing, then you can not recover. But if there's not too much turbulence in your recovery period, you'll kind of settle back down into a kind of thermostat level of happiness. I thought that was very encouraging. But it's interesting, an interesting question how the social scientists are going to maybe shed light on this. And it's an interesting question why people think that by ignoring the tragic side of life, they're actually happier, when arguably you can be happier if you pay some attention to that. And that brings us to my third point here, that one cannot be happy without a sense of gratitude, Aristotle teaches. It would seem like by paying attention to the tragic side of life, that would be depressing, and it would maybe undermine your happiness. But the Greek playwrights, those tragic playwrights, thought otherwise, and because someone like Aristotle would have seen all those plays. Most Greeks did. He saw them and he wrote a lot about them. So he came by this thinking honestly. And he thought that if you pay attention to the tragic side of life, it actually enhances your happiness. That's how it's paradoxical, because it makes you grateful for what you have. You know, the old saying, you only appreciate what you have when you lose it. Well, by paying attention to the tragic side of life, it raises your consciousness to the possibility you can lose what you have, and it makes you grateful for it. And so you embrace and express love for the people in your life and all the other blessings that you have in life from day to day. So paying attention to the tragic side of life is oddly a necessary condition for being happy. And that's one lesson that emanates out of the ancient Greeks. Another Aristotelian teaching about happiness is that unhappiness is easy, but happiness takes a lot of effort, takes a lot of hard work. It's unhappiness, if you think about it, is easy because it's very easy to go through life thoughtlessly, not paying attention to what you do. You just act so often on impulses. You just let your emotions be your guide. You don't master your emotions, and who knows where they're going to take you. And they can often take you into very unhappy positions. So a person who wants to manage his or her happiness has to be a very thoughtful person, and that takes hard work. Now, not everybody will be happy, but Aristotle says that everybody has the potential to be happy because everybody who's endowed with natural intelligence has enough wherewithal to manage their life so as to actualize their potentials. We have all kinds of potentials. We have physical potentials. We have emotional potentials. We have intellectual potentials. We have spiritual potentials. Happiness is not feeling good. Happiness is actualizing all these things in life. And you might actually go through sizable periods of life when you're not feeling good. And it's precisely because you're becoming happy, because you're doing the hard work of actualizing your potentials. And that takes a lot of effort. It takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of sacrifice. So a lot of people are kind of nonplussed. They're kind of upset when they find out that happiness takes hard work, because they like to think that happiness is just some kind of feeling. Or they like to think that happiness is something that happens to you externally, that you don't have much control over your life. And so they assume that you don't have much control over your happiness. But if you look at it that way, Aristotle says you'll be misled and you'll make a mistake. So if you think happiness is a feeling and you don't control your feelings, and you think happiness is something that happens to you from the outside, you get smacked in the head, yeah, I'm happy, or you get smacked in the head and yeah, you're unhappy. If you don't have any control over it, then you tend to think that happiness isn't hard work. You just kind of throw up your hands and give up. It's not something up to you. But Aristotle's position is just the opposite. He thinks that you are largely in charge of your happiness. Not entirely. Because remember, Aristotle is the philosopher of common sense, and so he'd be the first to admit that there's a certain amount of luck in your life. You can have sufficient bad luck in your life, and it will mar your happiness. It could even destroy your happiness. He's not naive that way. That's, again, part of the tragic condition, the tragic risk of life. But short of that, you have some control over your life. You have major control over your life short of that. And you're largely responsible for your happiness. And that's why happiness is tied into morality. Because we judge people in terms of their moral responsibility by how well they're living. And if they live rightly, their life is correlated to happiness. That's again why looking at families is the best way to understand happiness. Because who are the people most invested in your happiness? It's your parents. So the reason they try to bring you up as moral creatures is because they know that there's a very powerful correlation between being a moral person and being a happy person. So your parents, that's why they make you be polite at age 3, not tell a lie, be generous and unselfish and the like, because they know that they bring you up to be a responsible adult. That's to bring you up as an adult that takes into account other people, and that will be a happy adult. So again, that play back to the family. But Aristotle would not be so remiss as to ignore the possibility of luck. But he says, hopefully, luck isn't the whole story. Next, Aristotle would say, pay attention because happiness depends on intelligent decision making. You have to remind yourself that happiness is not a feeling, and therefore your intellect has to be involved. And so, not just in a very broad sense, but every day in the routine of your life, you have to remind yourself that you have a possibility of making a misstep, making some imprudent judgment that would lead you into some outcome that 20, 30, 40, 50 years later, you would look back on and regret that you ever made that kind of decision. So, as Dennis Prager puts it, he says, you have to ask yourself, will this, having this thing, taking this action, relating to this person, purchasing this item, even dwelling on this thought, will that make me happier or unhappier? Answering these questions demands constant thought and attention. So you have to use your intelligence. The good news is you don't have to be a genius, because Aristotle thought anyone equipped with natural intelligence had the wherewithal to see what they ought to do to actualize their potentials, especially if they've been brought up well. It had sufficient adult guidance that had put them on the pathway to having good habits. So when they get into the difficult decision-making events in life, they kind of have an inclination to make smart decisions and not make bad decisions. If you are brought up by good adults, as St. Thomas said, it's not impossible to be happy, but it'll be harder for you. And that's not impossible, but at least possible. And so there's some good news in that. In other words, Aristotle was a genius, but the good news is we don't have to be geniuses to follow his lessons about happiness and be happy ourselves. I remember the famous French writer Camus said, I don't want to be a genius. I find it hard enough just being a man. And I think that's a lesson for us all. What people lack, Aristotle would say, is they lack the awareness that happiness requires a great deal of thought. They just kind of fly by the seat of their pants and ignore that. And they often lack the self-discipline to overcome their natural inclination to do what is pleasurable. And they don't learn to get mature and defer gratification. So they will sacrifice what they ought to do, which may involve some hardship for something that's more momentarily pleasurable for them. And that's the sign of an immature person that can't make that distinction. And they lack the practical wisdom to consistently answer the question, will this make me happier or unhappier? And that brings us to our next one. One's happiness is likely to increase if one resists comparing oneself to others. Happiness is likely to increase if one resists comparing oneself to others. Aristotle would say you have to be on guard about whom you look at as someone you want to emulate. And it often happens that we compare ourselves to the wrong people. We misjudge the kind of people we're comparing ourselves to, and we feel deficient in the comparison, and this mars our happiness. he wasn't aware of Facebook, but the Facebook neurosis is a sign of this. You get on Facebook and you look there and say, those people are living such more interesting lives than I'm living. And so you feel depressed that you're not a happy person. Look at all those people. They look so happy. But that's not the way it works. You have to compare yourself to other people so that you'll have that gratitude and appreciate how good you've got it. I know I have a friend who is a missionary, and he was a whiny person. He was a constant complainer. He was morose. He was depressive. And he went on a mission trip to India, and he spent one day with people on a sidewalk in India. They'd been born on that sidewalk, and they spent their lives on that sidewalk, and they're going to die on that sidewalk. And this so affected him that his life was transformed. He never was a whiner or a complainer again, because he realized those are the people he should compare himself to. He's got a wonderful life, and he should be grateful for that. And because that blessing has come in his life, he ought to do something about it and give it back to people like those people in India. So a lot of it depends on whom you compare yourself with. We tend to compare ourselves with people that we think have better lives than ourselves, and in that sense, then we lose that sense of gratitude, which Aristotle said is a necessary condition for happiness. This was brought home to me some years ago. I had a friend who thought very highly of him. I thought he had this really idyllic kind of life, where he lived, what he did. And one time I spent a two-hour ferry ride with him from Bainbridge Island up by Seattle. And on that ride, he told me that a few years back, his wife and three of his children, I think he had six children, his wife and three of his children left one day, got in the car, drove to town, and on the way they were all struck and killed by a train instantly. I had no idea that this was the case. And I'm reminding myself that you really never know what kind of pain and demons people are carrying around. So you always have to be careful about comparing yourself with others for that reason. Have you noticed this? That when you know people well, you tend not to envy them or be jealous of them, even if they have a lot going for them. Because when you know people well, you know that. You know what pain and demons they're carrying around. You know they've got all kinds of baggage. They've got all kinds of difficulties. And that kind of takes the luster, the kind of abstract idealization of who and what they are. And that's an interesting point. They may be dealing with alcoholism and all kinds of other dysfunctions, drug addiction and the like. And once you know that, then you don't particularly envy them. Philo of Alexandria, first century philosopher, once said, this is why you have to be kind to everybody, because everybody's fighting a mighty battle. And that's where it's well kept in mind. And Aristotle says, this is the prescription about comparing yourself to others, is don't compare yourself to others. Compare yourself to human nature. Compare yourself to what it is to actualize a human being. That's why you should constantly be measuring or checking your life against the measurement of human excellence. And that'll get you out of that trap of feeling bad because you're not celebrated on Facebook or something like that. Okay? Don't confuse happiness with success. Now, Dennis Prager has some interesting things to say about this. There have been some social scientific research on this as well. Most people who are happy and successful were happy before they became successful. See, because this business about success is kind of tricky. You have to often ask, what constitutes success? There are all kinds of definitions of success, but we tend to have narrowed our conception of success down to a couple of things, down to financial and professional success. A lot depends on what you mean by success in this evaluation. I could bring in two people in here. I could bring in someone who was Mother of the Year. She's known for being engaged in all kinds of social service projects. She's a wonderful mother. She's beloved by her children. She's a blessing to the community. She may she may excel in her profession that doesn't pay very much. And then I could bring in some titan of business, some captain of industry, a billionaire, and in the eyes of the world, she's not a success and he is a success. And yet, he might not have a friend in the world. He might be like this guy, this subject of this famous poem by Edmund Arlington Robinson, Richard Corey. Richard Corey is a paradigm of a successful person. But look what happens to him. Whenever Richard Corey went downtown, we people on the pavement looked at him. He was a gentleman from sole to crown, clean favored and imperially slim. And he was always quietly arrayed. And he was always human when he talked. But still he fluttered pulses when he said, good morning, and he glittered when he walked. And he was rich, yes, richer than a king, and admirably schooled in every grace. In fine, we thought that he was everything, to make us wish that we were in his place. So on we worked and waited for the light, and were without the meat and cursed the bread. And Richard Corey, one calm summer night, went home and put a bullet through his head. So that's why success, you see, can be tricky, because it's not necessarily correlated with happiness. In fact, I've known many successful people who are happy, and they've told me that too, that they have always judged that their happiness was not dependent on their success, and that had they not been successful, they still thought they'd been happy. And I think this is one of the reasons people get into very neurotic habits in the pursuit of success, because they think they're unhappy, and then they think that by becoming successful, they'll compensate for unhappiness in their lives. It turns out it doesn't happen, and they can actually get into a kind of more miserable cycle. In fact, Dennis Prager cleverly observes, he says, that poor people who aren't successful are actually happier very often than successful people. And they're often certainly happier than successful people that are unhappy. Because poor people that are unhappy at least have the fantasy that if they became rich, they'd be happy. But the rich, successful guy doesn't have that fantasy anymore. So that's a curiosity in itself. Go back to something. Aristotle ties in happiness with moral life. And because moral life is an attempt to help you become an intelligent person in managing life choices, he says your happiness will depend on this kind of self-management. You have to be able to distinguish real goods and apparent goods. A real good is something that you desire because it can't be bad for you. It can only be good for you. We call real goods needs. Remember, a good is an object of desire. So we have all kinds of desires in life. Those desires that we ought to fulfill, which will make us flourish as a human being, are real goods, things that we really ought to desire. Examples would be food, clothing, shelter. If you're familiar with Abraham Maslow's levels of needs, he got them out of Aristotle. Food, clothing, shelter, health, love, meaning, meaningful work, a sense of liberty, recreation, physical pleasure, even a sense of yourself as a virtuous and excellent person. And that's not an exhaustive list, but that's very representative. And with regard to virtue, you have to have a regard for yourself as a courageous person, because he says courage makes all the other virtues possible. Because in managing your life toward your happiness, you're sometimes going to have to take risks, intelligent risks. And you have to be able to become a good decision maker. You have to moderate your inclinations, and you have to be fair to other people. In contrast with apparent goods are things you desire which may or may not really be good for you. You want them, but they may not be good for you. So if I get up in the morning and I want the breakfast of champions, which is, of course, Lucky Charms. What else could it be? And then I want to drink some Jack Daniels with that. And then afterward, I'll top it off with a pack of Camels. I may want that, but, of course, that wouldn't be smart to want that. And it would actually militate against my happiness, because how much I very much want it, it actually undermines what I need, my health. And so it would be foolish to do that. Now, that's an extreme example, but it makes the point that life, moral life, and our pursuit of happiness is a way of managing or navigating between our apparent desires, or our apparent goods, and our real goods. And so you have to make somehow your apparent goods harmonize with your real goods. So you should desire a nutritious breakfast, not an unhealthy breakfast. You want that, and then it also happens to harmonize with what you need, good nutrition in your life, to foster your health. So in a nutshell, that's what happiness comes down to. Somehow intelligently discerning apparent and real goods and making sure your apparent goods foster and don't undermine your real goods. That's, you could say that's Aristotle's ethics in a nutshell. Now, Manley talked about Aristotle. I wanted to say something about Thomas Aquinas here. Cicero wrote a book on friendship in the first century. He was influenced by Aristotle. And Cicero said that happiness has to be tied in with friendship. If you don't have friends, he says, what would be the point of happiness? If you're a happy person, you want to share your happiness with others, with family and friends and even the wider society. So friendship, Aristotle wrote a couple of books on friendship, and he was very committed to this idea. And again, this is something that modern social scientists have weighed in on, and they kind of worried about the state of kind of a breakdown of social cohesion and loneliness in modern society, our failure to have friendships. And if that's true, you have to have friendship to be happy, then there's a loss of happiness across the culture. This was very much basic to Aristotle's and St. Thomas's teaching, because they thought that human beings were by nature social animals. In fact, Aristotle went so far as to define the human person as a zoon politikon, a social or political animal, that you cannot be happy as a human being unless you have social interrelations. There are other beings that might be capable of that, he says. If you think that you can be happy and live a solitary life, you either must be a god or a beast. Zeus can do that, and a leopard can do that. That's just in their nature. But human beings can't do that. And for that reason, then, you have to have some kind of social love and connection in life. It's very hard to imagine how you could have happiness, even minimal happiness, if you're so atomized and separated from your fellow human beings as to live that way. And as I said, a lot of modern social scientists have come to agree with Aristotle and St. Thomas on this. These are three important studies, I think. One by Charles Murray here called Coming Apart, published in 2010, in which he talks about how there's been a kind of atomizing and fragmentation of American society. It's basically been a collapse of community. I'll go ahead and say something about the other two as well. And this famous study by Robert Putnam called Bowling Alone, very interesting title. When you think of, I know when I was growing up, when I thought of bowling, I thought of bowling leagues. My parents belonged to bowling leagues. All their friends belonged to bowling leagues. Now, he says, you go to a bowling alley, you won't see bowling leagues. You'll see people there bowling by themselves in their own lane. And he finds that very metaphorical, if not something more. And in this book here by Johann Hari, a very disturbing book called Lost Connections, which is a very recent book. This came out in 2017, I guess. And uncovering the real causes of depression and the unexpected solutions, he doesn't think that we'll find mental health through biochemistry and pharmacology. He thinks we'll find mental health in recovering this Greek genius about the zoon politikon, that we're political and social animals. And without social ties and friendship, we can't be happy. And because our society has become so fragmented and destroyed in this way, that's why there's a kind of epidemic of unhappiness in the culture. There are two sources of comparison I'd like to make with regard to what these three social scientists have observed at this kind of breakdown in American culture toward unhappiness. This is a fascinating essay by Lin Yutang, a Chinese philosopher, called Growing Old Gracefully in China. He grew up in China, and he lived in America for a while. He went to Harvard University. And he said that he loved both countries, but the thing he thought was most striking, in the most striking difference between the two was it was impossible to be lonely in China. It just wouldn't happen. There's a kind of downside to that. People won't leave you alone. But the upside is you could never contemplate, for example, growing old and having your family abandon you, put you in a home and ignore you. That will never happen in China. But it happens all the time, sadly, in the United States. And so Lin Yutang weighs into that and talks about that. And he says that it's a very sad feature. He thinks it's a byproduct of our radical individualism in American society, our sense of independence, where the old people themselves say, I don't want to be a burden to anybody. And so they themselves encourage the separateness. And so they die alone. And happens, sadly, very often. The best book on America to this day was written by a Frenchman named Alexis de Tocqueville in 1831 called Democracy in America. And one of the things he was struck by with America was the incredible social cohesion in the churches and the townships across America. And he thought that America would thrive and be healthy as long as that cohesion remained. And this is what concerns people like Murray and Putnam and Harvey. They think that social cohesion has been rapidly disappearing, if not already gone. Charles Murray says this. He says, "Today there's a sizable part of the population that lacks family, community, faith, and vocation. But a couple of generations ago, it had been inconceivable to find somebody who didn't have a connection with the family, community, faith, and vocation, at least some of those. But today you'll find people, you'll know people that have lost all contact with their family. They're not related to the community, small or larger. They've lost their religion, and they don't have a job. They basically live off the government. And that's a shocking outcome when you think about it sociologically. And Charles Murray is a sociologist. Here's Robert Putnam again, already referred to this. Bowling is one of the most popular leisure activities in the United States. And people used to do it in organized leagues. They would mingle and get to know each other. Today, people still bowl, but they do it alone. They're in their own lane, doing their own thing. This is a symptom, perhaps a metaphor, that the collective structure has collapsed." And Johan Hari says this. He has some shocking statistics in his book. Since social scientists have been asking a cross-section of U.S. citizens a simple question for years, how many confidants do you have? They've done this in Britain, too, and the answer is the same. They wanted to know how many people you could turn to in a crisis or when something really good happens to you. When they started doing this study several decades ago, the average number of close friends an American had was 3, but by 2004, the most common answer was none. It's worth pausing on that. There are now more Americans who have no close friends than any other option. My daughter was in the hospital some years ago, and I remember how sad it was that there was an older woman, she must have been well over 80, who told the nurses she was being discharged from the hospital. She asked the nurses to call a cab for her because she knew nobody that would come and take her home, which is a very sad thing. Now, Thomas Aquinas says, he's got all kinds of I told you so's about human history. And he would say that when you're talking about friendship, one of the friends that you can't forget, when there's a tendency, especially in the modern age, to forget this friend, we all talk about having a special friend. Well, St. Thomas believed you should have a special friend, and the most special friend you could have is God. And the reason you need God is because when you have God in your life and you realize that the human person is made in the image and likeness of God, it will motivate you to relate to your fellow human beings in a spirit of friendship. And also, he thought that there's something about the human psychology that needs God. Because, remember, according to Aristotle, happiness is just having all those real goods, attaining all those desires.